The very first and most important tip is when you design a part for printing, you consider that there's directionality to the print and gravity is working against you. So you want to create a part that does not have overhangs where an unsupported region of the part will require supports or it will be printing over thin air as the nozzle moves around. The nozzle will look like this and it's traveling around layer by layer, starting from the first one, depositing melted plastic once on top of another as it builds the part. So the best way to make the part difficult or come out poorly is to have a design that requires this overhang, something like this ceiling here that is going to need extra support and extra effort on the person that's manufacturing it. So if we generate supports here and click like that, it's going to automatically generate them. If we go ahead and prepare the print, it's going to create all this extra infill. These are support materials that are added as extra plastic to support the overhanging regions. And our job as designers in any given manufacturing process should be that we consider the design, how the design is going to be manufactured and the constraints associated with that manufacturing process. That means our very first job as designing for 3D printing is that we're going to consider the constraints involved and try to eliminate the supports. And that might sound like an extra burden to always be considering the build direction, but actually it's pretty well aligned with other manufacturing methods where we also have major constraints to consider. That happens with CNC machining, with blind features, that happens with injection molding, and it happens with stamping for sure. Pretty much any manufacturing process can be made vastly more difficult or impossible, and certainly costly, if the designer doesn't take into consideration what is the manufacturing process that will be used. So we can do the same thing with 3D printing, and we can make our parts much more rapidly made, easily made, and made with a low cost machine inside of the building instead of having to use the very, very expensive 3D printers. Try to use a minimum wall thickness of 1.5 millimeters, maybe even 2 millimeters. You can see in here, the sketch has these walls defined at 1.5. This is how the part flexes at 1.5 millimeters thickness. Most nozzles for common 3D printers are 0.4 millimeters hole diameter. When you import your part into a slicer, then the setting for the diameter will be here. And then you'll also have an extrusion width, which usually gives it a little bit of squish. So the width of the laid down plastic is a little bit wider than the width of the nozzle, or sometimes it's the same. The default might be 0.4 for yours. And when you generate your print, you're going to see that there's two walls. That's going to make up the two walls will make up 0.8, sorry, in my case it's 0.88, and then whatever is in the middle is being filled in with some given pattern. And in some cases, your wall thickness could force the slicer to avoid this space altogether if you don't allow enough space for a third path, and it's only a fraction of a path. Then you would end up with a hollow wall, which would be much, much weaker, because you would not have, you really need the adhesion between the inside and the outside wall to have any strength. To avoid supports when you're making holes in the vertical plane, then small diameters are acceptable, like 3 millimeters is okay. But after about 6 millimeters, the ceiling of the hole will fail to perform and you'll need supports. So the way this looks here is like that. You can see that the bottom of the hole comes out pretty accurately, but the top begins to deteriorate with the overhang. This is benchy, which is a very common benchmark type of print. It's not a perfect one, but this overhang feature, if you choose not to build any supports, it's very common to get it looking like that. And the width, I would say, is not quite acceptable. The width there is about 9 millimeters. So one other solution when you have a large hole is to put a, if it was a circle, put a teardrop shape so it comes to a point, and then you get a really nice build quality without any supports. If you want to make labels, we recommend using a deboss instead of emboss. So that means the part, the label, is cut into the plastic instead of protruding outward for the cleanest look. And the depth, a good depth to make it show up is 0.5 millimeters. That's a little bit more than one thickness of an extrusion width, so it's sure to show up. Here's how the label looks at 0.5 millimeter depth. And this is actually a little bit rushed. You can see the ringing in the font. If you slow down the speed of your printing, you can make it look much nicer. When you deboss this font like this, you can impact the strength of your component. But as you see here, if you choose a thin depth like 0.5 millimeters, then we don't have too much loss of material along this wall. Once in a while, you might need to have a fine tolerance like this cap that has a snug fit on the tube, okay? But you should only assume that you can achieve a 0.3 millimeters tolerance on any dimension for your printer. Here's why. When your printer lays down the extrusion, the extruded plastic is gonna have some squish. It's absolutely necessary for layers to adhere from one to the next one below it. And so the width of this squish is going to create this, well, in this case, it's a pattern of ins and outs that shows up on the surface of your part. And the thickness of this will be related to the height of your layer, where in this case, our layer is 0.3 millimeters. I like to print at 0.3. Many people print around 0.2 as a default on most slicers. Let's pretend each one of these bubbles is an extrusion path going into the board. This is the base, this is the plate of the printer. So what we just measured was 1.75 here, 1.75 here. And let's look closer. Let's look at this zone here. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and our design was 1.5 millimeters, so we have 0.25 excess, which means 0.125 overbuilt on each side. So this is the plus in regards to tolerance. So that means somewhere in here, we have the design. The designed wall was here on this dotted line, and somewhere outside the designed wall is where we built to. And this distance here is 0.125. I'd say that's pretty accurate. And you could ask your printer to achieve better, but we're not designing for what we can achieve. We're designing for what we can readily achieve. What's better than relying on a tight tolerance for a design like this one is, okay, we need that snug fit, but if you printed it slightly too large, you're going to have to reprint. And if you printed it too small, you'll have to sand out this entire surface, or maybe just reprint. So what do? Just make 3 contact points. And we use this feature, adding in this bump, and there's 3 of them. So the part maintains its center. And it also, we have the opportunity to just overbuild these bumps and sand them down. If they come out too large, we can just file down on that, on those zones, instead of trying to sand the whole inner surface. So the rule of thumb is, you measure your part, let's say like this blue tube, and then you want to make a mating part. We're not talking about a press fit, and we're not talking about a loose clearance fit, actually. We're just saying, what is the minimum to achieve a clearance so that your parts go together? And that rule of thumb is 0.3 millimeters. So if the inside diameter of this blue tube was 100 millimeters, then you would design the exterior of your gray cap here at this interface. You would make that 100 minus 0.3 millimeters on each side. And pretty much anybody that you send this print out to, it's gonna fit. And then the looseness will be another factor. You can look up press fits and clearance fits in design guides online. Those ones have been around for many decades. But 0.3 here is gonna give you the fitment so that it enters without interference of the blue part.